Yanni was woken up 43 seconds before his 11 o'clock alarm by a passing ambulance. It was called for 83-year-old Rosa Alonso. She had slipped on the tile of her kitchen floor while preparing her grandson Hugo's breakfast. Hugo, only 4 at the time, made the call to 911. Yanni's stomach groaned at him as he stepped in the shower. He hadn't been to the store since Wednesday. Dante was the first to arrive. He had taken the LIRR since the fare was reduced on the weekends, and he didn't want to be late like he always was. He had even laid out his favorite coat the night before so he could show them what a mature and stylish person he had become. As Yanni spoke to Dante, informing him of his new job as a remote telemarketer, he couldn't help but search his friend's face for signs of a shifting hairline. He had recently become more self-conscious after noticing his own forehead seemed larger when he looked in the mirror and had considered getting a prescription for finasteride to stimulate growth. Jill didn't understand why the boys couldn't have met her on the subway platform. She had gotten off the train from Brooklyn and knew she'd have to go right back and pay for another ride. Though she had said nothing to indicate to the boys that this was what she wanted, she was still somehow hurt that it didn't occur to them to save her the money. Before heading back to the subway, Jill wanted to stop and buy flowers. She didn't want to show up to see Mike empty-handed and felt that flowers would be appropriate. The local shop was closed for Sunday, and nobody knew if there'd be any when they got off the train. Jill settled on a bouquet for $16.99 at Walgreens that had clearly been on display for too long. She did her best to pick the dying ones out of the bunch. Dante told her not to bother, and that it wasn't like Mike would really notice. Jill said that wasn't funny. Jill thought briefly how all the flowers in the bunch were dying. Just some went faster than others. The train entered the station at the exact moment that Dante chose to relieve himself behind a gated staircase at the end of the platform. He said that with the way the trains were running lately, the MTA was lucky he didn't pee in the cars. Once off the train, Dante asked Jill and Yanni to wait for a moment while he popped in the nearby bodega. He said that he wanted to buy a drink for Mike, just like old times. Jill wasn't sure if Dante was joking again. In school, Mike was known for getting rowdy at parties and downing a full energy drink in one gulp. One time, Mike had given Jill a piggyback ride after one too many shotguns and attempted to take her up the stairs of their dormitory. She broke her collarbone in 2 places and was rushed to emergency surgery. Despite this somewhat traumatic experience, whenever Jill sees the scar that remains, she can't help but laugh. In the middle of their sophomore year at college, after he failed to meet his GPA requirements for the computer science track, Mike lost his financial aid package and was forced to move home. Jill had sent Yanni the address that morning and asked if he could map out the route to Mike, as her phone service had been acting strange lately. She was surprised and slightly irritated when Yanni brought them to the local church right in the middle of its afternoon mass. Dante watched as the congregation rose and began to scream, spit, and speak in tongues, channeling the Holy Spirit. One of the younger boys in the choir started to convulse violently on the floor. His parents, proud of his devotion, would later learn that this was the result of the golf ball-sized tumor pushing up against the boy's parietal lobe. Thankfully, the address that Jill sent was only off by a couple numbers, and their desired destination was only a bit further down the road. They reached the cemetery around 4. Jill was worried they wouldn't be able to find Mike before the gates closed, but she figured she'd leave the flowers regardless. Yanni was able to flag down a groundskeeper who directed them to the main building with a large touchscreen tablet, where they put in Mike's name. It said Mike was buried in Section 6, Row 6, Number 3. These numbers made Dante feel like he was trying to find his seats in a movie theater or a concert, and that they had to rush because the show was about to begin. The groundskeeper told them they could take their time. He didn't mind if they stayed a bit past closing and promised not to lock them in. Jill was very appreciative. Mike's plot was paid for by his stepfather, and despite never taking his surname while alive, it was printed largely on the top of the stone. After years had gone by without any response, Jill began checking the obituaries. Yanni thought this was a little morbid and pessimistic, but when Jill sent him a crowdsourcing page that raised $300 over the target to pay for Mike's memorial service, and that the service was dated for over a year ago, he was glad that she had kept looking. The obituary did not include Mike's cause of death, leaving them to wonder just what exactly got him in the end and his family's reasoning for not including it. There were a few scenarios that came to mind. Even though Mike hadn't been a part of her life for a long time, Jill wanted to come to see his grave but was afraid to do so alone. She was thankful both of the boys joined her. She wanted to see it with her own eyes. Maybe then it would feel real. Jill had kept Mike's hood ornament as a memento from the day after finding it amongst the debris of a drunk driving accident he had been in years before. She thought about bringing it today, possibly to leave at the grave. She decided it would be better saved. When Mike was a part of his life, Dante would have followed him anywhere. So why wasn't he sadder? Where did those feelings go? The only time Dante had ever seen his father cry was at the news of a childhood friend's passing. But Dante didn't have years of memories with Mike. He didn't know Mike's family. He didn't know how Mike died. Just that a guy he hadn't seen in years was dead and there wasn't anything else to be done about it than visit. Yanni thought that he would be glad to be reunited with his friends after all this time, but he wasn't sure how he felt now that he was with them. It was strange. Last Wednesday, Yanni had been thinking about Mike while doing the dishes at home. He wasn't sure why. Later that evening, Jill reached out to him and Dante to see if they wanted to pay him a visit. It was uncanny. He remembered feeling like someone was listening to his thoughts. Yanni thought about the universal law of attraction and the idea of manifesting. How putting out signals into the universe can attract the very thing you are signaling. It was almost like how some companies listen to people through their phones and TVs for data to be used in advertising. He wondered if the law of attraction was somehow just a very advanced form of targeted marketing. Yanni still hadn't eaten. As they stood in the station square, Jill spoke about how they should try to keep in touch more, and next time they should all do something fun together. Yanni said he'd like that, and Dante agreed. This would be the last time that Jill would see either of them. In a year, she would be offered a tech writing job and move to San Diego, where she'd meet Bill, a consumer analyst, and start a new life together. Dante would stay in the city working in fine art galleries, though never becoming a successful artist in his own right. He'd run into Yanni at artists' pop-ups and punk shows in the East Village some years later. They would wave to each other and catch up for a moment, regurgitating the highlights of the past few years concisely so as to let each other know they were all right, without needing to say anything of substance. Yanni would die at age 31, shortly after being struck down in the middle of the street by a drunk driver behind the wheel of a 1999 Honda Civic. But for now, he still needed to find something to eat.